Thank you for that introduction.
Yeah, while it's true that we're awesome, it's more that we are both basically from Germany, and that makes us awesome. Where's Kat? So we learned about lots of topics that we shouldn't touch, and so we won't. We will go right into the talk.
Yeah, we want to talk about DevOps and legacy code.
But we left out the code, because while preparing for the talk, we realized that it's not about code. Not only. It's about legacy stuff. And therefore, we just removed the code, and we will talk about the topic a bit differently.
Yeah, and we like to start with why we are doing things. If I get up in the morning, I want to know why this doesn't work, and I also... Okay. I like it.
Did you bring legacy batteries? Maybe.
No, these are state of the art new batteries. But
I mean, in reality, we just prepared for 25 minutes, so we just do this like 5 minutes.
I don't think. It's the clicker. Give me a second. Peter, entertain them.
Yeah. I could touch the topics that we are not supposed to touch, so.
No, yeah. And we are back on track. Why do we want to do DevOps, whatever that means, to use the tools and the practices we've learned about? There are several reasons. First of them, we don't want to be afraid anymore. If you are in a organization with a huge legacy code base, these huge monoliths, the next release that's going to happen in half a year, it's scaring you right now. And it's scaring everyone else in the company right now. And you're living in the constant fear of the next release, and you try to get your vacation booked around that time to not be in the room when that happens. And we want to be releases to be a non-event. We don't want to be afraid anymore.
The second thing is we don't want to have sleepless nights. Agreed. They were cool when we were 20, but Ollie is really old now. He has 4 kids. I've got 3, so we need our nights to soothe our children and not work with our systems.
And also the next topic is related to sleep. We want to have systems that we can rely on. I'd hate it if I get woken up at 3 a.m. in the morning just to fix some stupid server that's broken down. I want to stop having to fight fires all the time.
Exactly. And the fourth reason that is important to us is that we want to look inside of the systems that we work with and that we develop. And we don't want to do that sometimes. We don't want to do that by chance or when something bad happens. We want to be able to do that all the time.
And next question would be, okay, how do we do it?
And this is a complete list. You know it. It's all the things that make up DevOps. Nothing will change here. So this will be the list forever and ever.
Thank you for the talk. No, honestly, we have mechanisms. We have tools that help us achieve the goals that we just set out. But then why is it so hard?
And the reason is... the first one is we have simple solutions for complex problems. It's an acronym that we just made up, and it's the thing we see over and over again. We see a problem, we say, oh yeah, that's simple to fix, and we fix it. But once we have fixed it, we realize it's not that simple at all. And so we create something more complicated, we create something even more complicated, and in the end it's unmaintainable, it's really a mess. This is one of the reasons why it's hard.
Another one is tight coupling. We have systems that are composed of hundreds, thousands even, of modules or different moving parts, and they all rely on each other very, very strictly, and if one of them doesn't work as expected, the whole system doesn't.
The next reason is specialists. Every one of us is a specialist in one kind, and we are really, really good in our organizations to make us more special and more expert and put us into even smaller silos every day. This is part of the problem, because having the specialist status and being a specialist creates more need for communication. It does not, unfortunately, create more communication.
Our systems are becoming increasingly brittle. That means they are designed for the happy path. They are designed for customer influx of requests for customers that we know the rate of. If we are surprised, things break down. It's designed for a network that is reliable. If it's not, our systems break down. Whenever something unexpected happens, our systems crumble down like a card house.
And this is exactly the point why I was a developer before I became an Agile coach, because I wanted to think about the happy path. I didn't want to think about the mess that we have in production. And this is part of the brittleness that we create, because we are focusing on a too narrow path of the or part of the infrastructure and systems.
And in our organizations, we often accept manual processes. They have a huge legacy, they have a huge tradition of, okay, if you're doing the deployment once a year, once every 6 months, it's fine to shut down the systems by hand and to update them by hand and to restart them by hand. It's fine to have a configuration change done manually. And this makes it hard for us to get to our goals.
But the question remains, why is it so hard? Because these are problems that we know, and we have the tools. So if you look back at the last slide, which we won't do because the animation would start over again, but if we would do that, we would see, hey, there are tools for that. There are processes for that. There are means that we have to this end.
So the real problem is it's all in one place. We don't have just a brittle system. We don't have just tight coupling. We have all of that and much more. And it's just an overwhelming problem.
And it's interconnected. Yeah, yes. That's what makes up complexity. And so while we know, the overwhelming helps us there, while we know that our problems are overwhelming, we had the same problem when we were preparing the talk, because we saw this and we were like, okay, 25 minutes, 5 minutes for each of the problems, except the introduction and the outro, this wouldn't work. And so we decided to just go for one topic and create a small slice of the cake. And that's why we'll only talk about tight coupling today.
And tight coupling for us, it comes in different flavors. We have tight coupling in our architecture, infrastructure, and code. But also we have tight coupling in our processes. We have tight coupling of persons that are coupled tightly.
And since we are Germans, we like definitions.
Yes.
We like to define stuff. So if we talk about coupling, it is the degree of interdependence between things.
And a measure of how closely these two things are actually connected to each other.
And the strength of the relationships between the things. And
we are Germans. We want to know what things are, right?
First of all, I would like to talk where we stole this, because we did not invent it. This is part of the Wikipedia article for coupling when it comes to software engineering. It talks about modules. But coupling, as we just said, is not just about software modules. It's about more things. And so things for us are?
It can be our software components that we traditionally think about. But it also can be our infrastructure. It can be code. It can be people. It can be whatever else there is that is tightly coupled that we didn't think of. And again, this is something we could do a two-day, a three-day workshop about. We have probably like 15 minutes left, won't work. So again, we focus on the three points at the left, the architecture, the infrastructure, and the code for today.
And let's go into the first example. So let's talk about architecture. And this is a real example. It was at one of my customers, Oliver was in the same company, but he did not solve that hard problems. He solved the easier ones. Because what we had was an application, and this application was a big ball of mud, you know the pattern. So it was a monolithic system. Maybe you can show it. It was an application, and in this application we had tons of stuff going on. And one thing was that sometimes we had to tell people, we had to greet people, like dear Mr., dear Mrs., dear Professor, Doctor, whatever. We encapsulated this into a small helper. No problem. We had a component or several components using this salutation helper. But over time, the coupling between these different parts of the system, it became too much. And so what we did is we refactored the salutation helper into an external service. We created some messaging infrastructure that we connected to the service, and then we switched over the first component to this new service. And yes, this is ridiculously simple. This is a baby example, but we now had our first occurrence of this decoupling going on.
And you could, if you had to, because your application is so huge and complex that you can't do all of it at the same time. You could do this as a first step. The architecture of the application got a slightly bit less tightly coupled, but we have duplicated code. We don't want to stop there, but it can be a kind of a milestone, kind of a step in between.
And therefore, we did not stop there. We refactored the other components step by step, sprint by sprint. We removed a couple of those. Often it was parts of the code that we were touching anyways. Sometimes we just did it because we wanted to get rid of the salutation helper. And in the end, we were able to just remove it. Is this ridiculously simple? Yes, it is. Is this something that you might not think about doing because it is so a non-problem? Maybe. And maybe you shouldn't, because you should, because in the end, what you have here and what we had here was knowledge. We learned something from this experiment. Even in this very simple service that we created, we learned about problems setting up independent services, deploying them independently, and running them independently. With that as a blueprint, we could do other stuff and could continue our travel towards a better infrastructure and a better system.
Let's talk about infrastructure. Suppose Peter and I, we run a beard accessory store. Obviously, everyone needs beard accessories, at least we do, and we are going to have a huge customer base. Watch out for it, it will be huge. We are going and start with a simple setup. We have a web server running some code, and we have a database where we store all of our products and all of the orders that the people place. And the web server is handling the sessions, so the shopping carts and whether you're logged in or not, what's your name. We handle that on the web server because the database is running on disk, and disk is too slow for us, so we want to have that in memory. And then we go live, we tell you about a new shop, and every one of you is going to order razors, shaving cream, whatever. We will have a lot of sessions on our web server. And in the end, the web server will be full and can't handle more customers. We are going to lose revenue. No, we won't. We will have a second web server. And then we can continue to grow.
And the problem starts here, because now we have doubled the chance of getting woken up in the night because one of the machines dies. We have a problem when we want to update, because we have sessions that live in a volatile environment, and we don't want that. And we want less tightly connected systems. And so what we do is,
we set up a central session store. This is kind of a database, but faster because it's happening in memory, and I don't really care which product you use. But what we want to do is we want to move the sessions away from the web server and have it at one central location. Oops, sorry.
And this is not what our talk is about. It's not about convincing you that web servers with sticky sessions are a bad thing and you should do something else.
Because you know that already.
You should. And what we really want you to tell you is that it's about the principle. Again, it's a very simple or a comparatively simple problem that you have in your infrastructure, and you try to solve that. You try to make it one step better, which means one part less hurtful.
And this, again, this is something that we've seen with our clients, with market leaders, and not just with a small bird accessory store that's starting up, but with huge companies. They have the problem with these sticky sessions, and they can't do blue-green deployments even if they wanted to. They have problems going international because BGP somehow doesn't understand sticky sessions. And this is real problems that we've seen several times.
And if you came for the DevOps and legacy code part, listen, comes cool. Now. It's like 3 minutes. Because when we talk about code, and you all know this. So again, these examples, they are not new. They are not exciting. It's just common sense to us. So when we talk about code, we have parts of code classes that depend on other classes directly. Foo knows bar, and maybe we want to decouple that. Maybe we want to encapsulate that in a different part of our source code.
Use interfaces, whatever. We have globally shared variables. Everything depends on this variable defined somewhere. Perhaps you have a service for your configuration that gives out configuration. Perhaps you solve it some other way, but this is tight coupling. If you're relying on that one, every other piece of code is going to break if you break that or if you remove that part.
Maybe something less obvious, but still hurtful. You are relying on an old or low-level library like HTTP client in Python. You want to remove that and replace it with something more high-level like requests. You have this piece of code spread throughout your whole landscape, and you have to touch thousands and maybe thousands and thousands of occurrences. And again, decoupling, encapsulation, proper code design. This is your. This is what you want to do here.
Also, stuff like WSDL.
Yeah, which is again, it's even less obvious because here we have done the right thing. We have created a service, and this is an external service that we can approach. But still, we are tightly coupled through the protocol that we talk about, which in that case is just the web service definition language. And the younger ones don't recognize this piece of XML because these days you all do it in YAML, right? And it's
there's a talk about that later.
There is a talk about that. You should go there. But the interesting thing is, again, we have solved the problem. So why is it so hard?
Because we really believe how this works, and we have the patterns. We know be strict in what you do, but be accepting in what others do, and everything's fine. Next slide.
Yeah. And this is what this talk is really about. This talk is not about code. This talk is not about architecture. This code is not about infrastructure. This code really is about baby steps.
Because in the end, DevOps is about a mindset and a culture and not about how you do code stuff. And we don't believe that a big bang will ever work. If you're in a situation where you have legacy code, there's always someone who says, okay, let's rewrite this stuff from the scratch and do it right this time. And you have a project for the next 2 years, and then we will switch over, and it's going to be a big disaster. I've never seen it work.
Yeah, that would have been my question. So Oliver always tells things. I would have asked how many of you have seen this work? Right, no one.
One hand.
Oh, really? Yeah, let's talk after the talk. There is always the next baby step. So as soon as you have fixed one thing, and it can be the most tiny thing that you have. Imagine you buy we are in London, you don't buy apartments here. Imagine you buy a car, a used car. And not everything is perfect in this car. Maybe you are even a poor IT consultant like I am, and you buy a very old car. And so you have to fix stuff. You have to fix the tires and the brakes and the motor, and the coating is bad. You can't do it in one go because you're poor. You have three kids, and they need food. So
what you're doing is you look at the car and find out what's the most pressing problem, what's the most painful part. Perhaps it's flat tires. The motor sounds a bit strange, but the flat tires are really the thing that's preventing you from using the car. So you just focus on that one. And you just change the tires and leave the motor, leave the coloring, leave the broken radio, whatever. Just focus on that one.
And then, once you have fixed the most pressing thing, you fix the next pressing thing and the next pressing thing. And this brings us to, this is a temporal thing. So your legacy systems, your legacy code has not appeared out of nothing. You have built it. If I look back at code that I wrote last week, and I did write code last week, I look at it today, I think, like, why? WTF, anyone? The other one? So what did I do there? This is legacy code. This is a legacy problem. And it will take time to fix it. So if I see that, and if I see a quick fix, why shouldn't I do it? It's just like with the Boy Scouts. Leave the campground a tiny bit cleaner than you have seen it.
And in the beginning, there were no stupid people. If it was me writing the code last week, probably it was a stupid person. But in the other cases, they are not stupid. We've seen we scaled our web shop from one web server to another one, to a second one, a third one, and problems arise. It was not a stupid decision to do that. It was a natural decision. But over time, things grew bad. And so we have to redo things over time and fix things over time. We won't save the world in one day, but we can save the world if we do it baby step by baby step.
Exactly. Thanks. If you want to know more about that, we would be very happy if you join us in an open space talk later where we can talk about other examples, or we would like to know your examples. So if you want to have one of the t-shirts that Ollie is currently having, just tweet and tag the conference and tell us about what is interesting about legacy that you have seen, or a surprising part of legacy, or a surprising effect that legacy has. And if it's really, really funny, and Germans have a weird sense of humor, so if it's funny for us, you can have a t-shirt. The problem is, we have all the right sizes, so we only have L and XXL left. So,
but we want to hear the stories of everyone else. You just won't get a fitting t-shirt.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.